At the church, and it's a privilege to teach this morning for Sunday school. So glad you could join us in this platform, and it's such a joy to be able to open God's Word and study it and teach it. And I hope today will be a blessing. Today we will finish the series on streams in the desert. This is the last lesson in this series, so I've been able to teach a few of these in this platform and share these with you. The remainder of the beginning ones I taught to our class when we were meeting in person. And so it's a privilege to be able to finish this up today. And today we're going to be in the book of Genesis, chapter number 32. And there we're going to find the familiar story to most of us. We're going to find Jacob. And we're going to find Jacob wrestling with an angel. And so we're going to look at this scripture together, going to study it together, and really ask the Lord to speak to your heart this morning as you listen to this. And maybe you're listening at a different time than our normal 10 o'clock hour. Whatever this the case may be, pray that the Lord would speak to all of us and convict us and help us to grow closer to Him. Let's pray, and then we'll begin our Sunday school lesson today. Lord, I thank You for this time. Lord, I thank You for Your Word. Lord, this is a familiar passage of Scripture to most all of these that may be watching or listening. Yet, Lord, it's alive. Yet, Lord, when I studied it, when I read it, there's things that I saw that spoke to me that I didn't see before or that I saw afresh. And, Lord, I pray that we won't look at this passage and necessarily tune this out because it's something familiar. But, Lord, You'll help us, Lord, to understand it more deeply and to see things that we may not have seen. To, Lord, allow our hearts to be open to hear Your Word and understand Your Word more clearly. Thank You for the opportunity to teach Your Word. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. If you'll turn your Bibles to the book of Genesis, Genesis 32, we will begin looking at that passage here in a moment. Again, I mentioned this is the series on streams in the desert, and this is a series through Striving Together Publications, and really the idea that God is still able to help us and provide streams in the desert. When we think of the desert, we think of a very dry place, a very desolate place. Yet, in the midst of things that go on in our life, like the trials and the tribulations that we may have, the times of testing, of difficulties, of confusion, we know that we serve a God that is able to provide a stream in that desolate place, in that place of loneliness, in that place of confusion. Yet, we serve a God that provides that stream in the desert. So we're going to find today in this passage that the Lord did that very thing, that our God provided a stream in the desert. The title of our lesson today is Wrestling with an Angel, and it comes from Genesis chapter 32. The key learning principle that I want us to think about today is the principle of prayer. How important that prayer is in our life. How important that it is that we have a relationship, a fellowship with our God, praying about the things of our hearts, the concerns of our hearts, lifting up praise to Him. We're going to find that today as well. We see that, again, the key text is at chapter 32. Before we get there, let's take a little account of the background leading up to chapter number 32. This is the account here in 32 of chapter 32, the account of Jacob wrestling with the angel all night long. He has the opportunity here to shed his reputation as the deceiver. Again, if you think about his brother Esau and what he did in the previous chapters in Genesis, he has an opportunity to shed that reputation he has and take on a new name. That name would be Israel. We see this. This was all possible because he spent time in prayer and he spent time in communion with his God, and how important it is for us to do the same in our life today. Jacob begins acting childish with his brother Esau, and they were arguing over and trying to deceive each other, and finally got to the point where Jacob fled home. Here we see in the chapters leading up to chapter 32, Isaac, his father, is nearing death. Esau wants the same outcome in Jacob's life. He wants him dead because of the way he deceived him. And Jacob goes on and lives with Laban, his uncle, and was to come to find out his uncle Laban was a bigger cheat and a deceiver than he was. Chapter 32, he here now leaves Laban and is preparing to meet Esau for the very first time since all this happened many years ago. I can imagine that there was great distress that leads him to realize that God's in control of the affairs of men, and prayer changes things. Prayer, we can intervene in the lives, our lives and the lives of others by the communion and the prayer we have with our Almighty God. So we're going to look at three particular aspects of this passage. First of all, we're going to see the stress of Jacob. We're going to see the stress that he was under. We're then going to see the scheming of Jacob. And then finally, we're going to see the struggle with the angel. Again, a passage we're all familiar with, but we pray that as we look at this, that it'll be fresh and anew as we study it. First of all, we're going to look at the stress of Jacob. This is found in Genesis chapter 32, verses 1 through 8. Let's read that together. Starting in chapter 32 and verse 1. It says, "And Jacob went on his way, and the angels of God met him. And when Jacob saw them, he said, 'This is God's host.' And he called the name of that place Mahanaim. And Jacob sent messengers before him to Esau, his brother, and to the land of Seir, the country of Edom. And he commanded them, saying, 'Thus shall ye speak unto my lord Esau, thy servant Jacob saith thus, I have sojourned with Laban and stayed there until now. And I have oxen and asses and flocks and men servants and women servants. And I have sent to tell my lord that I may find grace in thy sight.'" Verse number 6, we continue reading. It says, "And the messengers returned to Jacob, saying, 'We came to thy brother Esau, and also he cometh to meet thee, and 400 men with him.' Then Jacob was greatly afraid and distressed, and he divided the people that was with him, and the flocks, and the herds, and the camels, into two bands, and said, 'If Esau come to the one company and smite it, then the other company which is left shall escape.'" Let's stop our reading there and talk about this part of the passage. You know, stress causes worry. And worry, if we are really honest with ourselves, worry, even in my own life, when I have worry, when I worry about things, the fact is we're not trusting, fully trusting in God's plan for our lives. Jacob is currently trying to handle his problems on his own with the stress that is increasing. He here sends the messengers, and he's taking care and thinking, I'm going to reach out to Esau first, and I'm going to tell him I've got all the oxen and the ass and the flocks and the servants, and I'm going to take care of this on my own. And because of that, we see that it ended up in the distress and the worry and the fear that Jacob started to feel in his life. We're going to first see here the escape from Laban. If we go in the chapter right previous to this, in Genesis 31:20, we see that he arose and left without telling Laban. We see that he's on the run for his life. In fact, he was able to run away from Laban before Laban caught up to him for 7 days. And Laban does finally catch up to him, but does not harm him, because Laban tells Jacob that he has heard from his God that he had been given strict instructions, specific instructions, not to do him harm. I can imagine if I was Jacob and I was on the run, you know, we've run from things. Many of us have run from things before that we might have been afraid of, may have chased for something. Some of us don't like snakes, and we see a snake and we run from it. Some of us don't like mice, and we see mice and we run from it. The fact is, when we're running from something, there is worry, there is fear, there is stress. And I can imagine here for Jacob that there was a lot of stress in the running away from Laban. So we see his stress was increasing here. And Jacob offers a sacrifice to God later in that chapter because of the protection that he offered Jacob in the hands of his uncle Laban. So we then see not only the escape from Laban, but now that we're in chapter 32, we see the anticipation of Esau. We see that he meets the angels of God. We see that in the first couple verses of this passage we read. And this is an indication of the strengthening and the comfort for the journey ahead. You have to consider the last time that he met Esau. The last time he met Esau, Esau was very angry. He wanted his brother Jacob dead. And he was upset for the way that Jacob had handled himself and deceived for the birthright. And so that's what's on Jacob's mind right now. He's the anticipation of this next meeting with Esau. The guilt of wrongdoing undoubtedly haunted Jacob. The stress level continued to be high. We can all think of a time in our life when we have maybe done something that was not right, and we realize it. We know we've done wrong, and we know we have to have a conversation with that person to get things right, to address the problem. And that causes a lot of stress and a lot of worry and a lot of things going on in our life. He had a choice to make. At this point, Jacob could either trust the Lord to work it all out, or he could try to take care of the situation on his own, and on his own strength, and on his own might, and on his own rationale, and on his own knowledge and understanding. And we're going to see the journey that Jacob goes through, finally to wrestling with the angel in the coming passage. So we see the stress of Jacob in the first 8 verses of this chapter. We're going to pick up our reading in verse number 9. And we're going to see the scheming of Jacob. What does Jacob do? What does he scheme to try to figure out? How does he choose to handle this situation? So let's look and start reading in verse number 9. We'll pick up our reading and read through verse number 23. So in verse number 9 it says, "And Jacob said, O God of my father Abraham, and God of my father Isaac, the Lord which saith unto me, Return unto thy country and to thy kindred, and I will deal well with thee. I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies and of all the truth which thou hast showed unto thy servant. For with my staff I passed over this Jordan, and now I am become 2 bands. Deliver me, I pray thee, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau. For I fear him, lest he will come and smite me, and the mother with the children. And thou sayest, I will surely do thee good, and make thy seed as the sand of the sea, and which cannot be numbered for multitude. And he lodged there with that same night, and took of that which came to his hand a present for Esau his brother, 200 she-goats, and 20 he-goats, 200 ewes, and 20 rams, 30 milch camels with their colts, 40 kine, and 10 bulls, 20 she asses, and 10 foals. And he delivered them into the hand of his servants, every drove by themselves, and said unto his servants, Pass over before me, and put a space betwixt drove and drove. And he commanded the foremost, saying, When Esau my brother meeteth thee, ask thee, saying, Whose art thou? And whither goest thou? And whose art these before thee? Then thou wilt say, They be thy servant Jacob's. It is a present sent unto my lord Esau. And behold, also he is behind us. And so commanded he the second and the third, and all the followed the drove, saying, On this manner shall ye speak unto Esau when ye find him. So here we see, and we're at verse number 20, we see that Jacob called out for God. Now we see that Jacob going back and talking about the things that he's going to do here as he meets his brother Esau. We'll continue reading in verse 20. It says, And say ye moreover, Behold, thy servant Jacob is behind thee. For he said, I will appease him with the present that goeth before me. And afterward I will see his face, peradventure he will accept of me. So went the present over before him, and himself lodged that night in the country, in the company. And he arose up that night and took his two wives and his two women servants and his 11 sons and passed over the ford Jabbok. And he took them and sent them over the brook and sent them over that he had. Verse 24, we're going to stop reading right there. And so this is the point where Jacob talks about the scheming that he's going through. So for a moment, as we started reading in verse number 9, for a moment it appeared that Jacob finally understood that he was giving up control of the situation for himself. He spent his life manipulating. He spent his life lying and deceiving. And, you know, inevitably he knows the outcome. He knows what happened when he had that happen and knew what the outcome was. And we finally, for a moment, seems like Jacob understood that. First of all, we see that he prays as though it all depends on God. You know, verse 9, he calls out to God. Calls out to the God of my father Abraham, the God of my father Isaac. Here we see him calling out. You know, he reminds him that he promised safety if he returned home. In other words, he's saying, Lord, you promised me that if I returned to my kindred, my home, my country, that you would provide safety, that you would multiply my seed. The promises that God had made, he's reminding and bringing to memory these things. He acknowledges his past failures. We see there in verse 10, he says, I'm not worthy of the least of all mercies. And of all the truth, all the things that he did, Jacob saying, listen, I'm a failure. I've failed. I have done wrong. I've cheated. I've lied. I've deceived. Yet you're still showing mercy on me, and yet you promised to do that. He cries out for that mercy, even though he's not. He realizes that he is not worthy. But the lessons that Jacob must learn is not over yet. We see that he has not given him complete control by faith. Have you been there? Have I been there in a time of our life where we feel impressed by the Holy Spirit and we know the right thing to do and we cry out to God, yet we get up from kneeling to pray and we walk down 10, 15 minutes down the path of life and yet we're trying to control it all over again. I'm guilty. I've been there. I've done it. And we all have. Yet the Lord wants us to have true faith, true trust in Him, and give this over to Him and learn to let Him have complete control in our life. So we see that he first prays as though it all depends on God, but yet we see him work as though it all was left up to Him. We see in the verses 13 through 23, again, we read through many of those that talked about the things that he was going to provide, trying to manipulate his brother. In other words, he knows his brother's mad, upset for what he did, and he's thinking, wow, if I send all this stuff ahead of time, and I give him all these things that I own, and all these riches that I have, and all the livestock, and all the things, then it'll ease his mind. It'll pacify him enough that he won't be so upset when I see him face to face for the first time. He won't want to take my life. And so he sent ahead much gifts. He did not, at this point, he did not assume that God was going to protect him. In other words, he's crying out for mercy in the beginning in verses 9, 10, 11, 12, yet he turned around and did not apply what he was praying. And he fell back into wanting to take care of things on his own. You know, I think of this, the note here is, when we trust in our own resources, it will always cost us something. Amen. Think about that. When we trust in our own resources, it will always cost us something. How true is that in our life? And how we make the mistake time and time again, and don't trust and don't put our full faith into His plan, into His cause in our life. And we try to take things into our own control, and we end up messing it up each and every time when we do that. And it costs us. It costs us something. Here we see that it cost Jacob all sorts of personal belongings that he had in order to get this ahead when he tried to take care of things in his own might. So we see that he worked as though it was all left up to him. So the scheming of Jacob. We see the scheming ending in verse 23. And now we're going to look at the struggle with the angel. And we see this in verses 24 through the end of the chapter there, and close to the end in chapter at verse 30. So let's read through verse 30. And it says here, pick up in verse 24. It says, "And Jacob was left alone, and there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day. And when he saw that he prevailed not against him, he touched the hollow of his thigh, and the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, 'Let me go, for the day breaketh.' And he said, 'I will not let thee go, except thou bless me.' And he said unto him, 'What is thy name?' And he said, 'Jacob.' And he said, 'Thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince hast thou power with God and with men, and hast prevailed.' And Jacob asked him and said, 'Tell me, I pray thee, thy name.' And he said, 'Wherefore is it that thou dost ask after my name?' And he blessed him there. And Jacob called the name of the place Peniel, for I have seen God face to face, and my life is preserved." And so we see here the struggle with the angel. And so Jacob was all alone now. You know, I read that and I thought, wow, isn't that the time so helps us realize that if we're going to hear from God, if we're going to follow God's will, if we're going to let go of self and let God take control, we need time alone. We need time alone with God. We need time alone to commune with God, to be in His Word, to be in prayer, to ask the Lord the concerns of our heart. And we see here, in fact, that Jacob was alone. If we want to find the will of God, we must spend time alone with God. God lets Jacob struggle all night because he is as concerned not only about the end, but also the means by which we get there. The Lord cares about what each individual part of our life. And we have to realize here that we must live a life that He can bless. He not only cares about the final outcome and the salvation of our souls and the presence of Him upon our death here in our earthly bodies, the presence with Him in our heavenly bodies. Not only is He concerned with the outcome, the ultimate outcome, but He is concerned about the means in which we get there. Our life wants to be a life that He can bless. And it's a heart change. We heard a message Pastor Herman shared with us that I can't get away from about the heart matter. It's a matter of your heart. With the way we live and the way that we act as Christians, it's because the Lord has changed our heart. And we want to follow Him and follow His will. God lets Jacob struggle here because He wants him to live a blessed life. We see that there is power. First of all, power in heavenly communion requires commitment. So if you want to have power, you have to have commitment. Here we see that Jacob believed that Jacob begins to wrestle with the pre-incarnate Christ. There are, if you study this passage, many that believe that this is a struggle with pre-incarnate Christ. In fact, that struggle is alluded to in Hosea chapter 12, verse 4. Let's turn there. There's not much turning in this lesson as far as a reference goes. But just this one verse, if you want to turn to Hosea, you're going to find Hosea shortly after Daniel. You'll find the book of Hosea in the Old Testament, and we're going to be in chapter number 12 and verse number 4. It says, "Yea, he had power over the angel and prevailed, and he wept and made supplication unto him. He found him in Bethel, and there he spake with us." Here it references the struggle that Jacob had here in reference to the pre-incarnate Christ. Now, the verse references there in Hosea that references Jehovah, but we have to understand here that Christ dwells as the fullness of the Godhead in the bodily form here on earth. When He was here on earth, He had the full Godhead and all the parts thereof, the fullness of the Godhead. And so Jacob realized his opponent was beyond ordinary, beyond ordinary. He was wounded in the thigh, but still was hanging on. How many times, too many times as Christians in our own Christian walk, that we give up and we stop praying before God blesses? Do you realize here that Jacob was hanging on, was not letting go, even though he was wounded, even though it hurt, even though he had a thigh issue there, the thigh was out of joint, he didn't stop. He continued. He was committed because he wanted the blessing, that he wanted God's blessings. And too many times, we stop short of the blessings of God because we stop short in our commitment to God. God wants us to call out to Him in importunity. Importunity means persistence. That means we're going to call and keep calling. And we're going to keep asking and not give up asking until He meets our need. And we see here that that's exactly what Jacob displayed here with his struggle with the angel. Jacob learns that blessing comes after we have been broken and can do nothing but cling to God. That's when true blessing comes. And so we see that in order to have power in heavenly communion, it requires commitment. We then see, and finally, our final point, with the struggle with the angel, we see that the confrontation with the Holy One changes us. Here we see that he was clinging to the Lord. And because he was clinging to the Lord, we see that he was no longer called Jacob. He had a name change. Jacob meaning deceiver. Yet now he was known as Israel, which was a prince with God. A name change and his walk changed. Reminder, you know, here we see that he had a limp for the remainder of his life because of this meeting with the Holy One. It's important for us to note here that if we apply this to our Christian life, when we meet Christ, not only does our name change, and we are now called Christian, you, ma'am, you, sir, when you call upon the name of the Lord and you are saved, you have the name Christian. You have the name of Christ as your name. Not only is your name changed, but our walk, our lifestyle changes as a result, because our heart has changed. Here we see that it's because of a changed heart that we have a changed lifestyle and our walk is different. Just like we see here with Jacob, with the encounter with the Holy One. And so we see here the importance of this passage and the importance of the struggle with the angel. So as we draw a close this morning to our Sunday morning adult Sunday school class, we see in the desert that God provided a stream by which Jacob to fellowship with him. He provided that stream. We saw Jacob's stress lead to his schemes of handling the problems on his own in front of him, followed by his struggle with the angel. So in way of application, first let's think about worry and stress. When we worry, we know that it increases the stress levels in our life. And we can think of many reasons in the past months that we could worry. We could be fretful over the situations that go on around us. Fretful when we turn on the news and see the things that are going on around us. Fretful about the things that affect us directly in our jobs or our families or our health. So many things that have been brought to light in the recent months. Yet, if we're not careful, we can easily be consumed, absolutely consumed with worry. Elizabeth Elliot said, "Worry is the antithesis of trust. You simply cannot do both. They are mutually exclusive." Church, we can either trust or we can worry. We can't do both. They're mutually exclusive. What will you do with your stress and your worry? Learn from Jacob. Pray and trust our Almighty God. Are you weary in praying for a need in your life? Is there something that you've been praying for months, maybe years, and you're growing weary in your prayer? It's making you tired. It's causing you to wonder about whether it's going to be ever answered or whether the Lord hears you. Christian, I'll ask you, God desires us to pray with importunity until we receive His blessing. Pray and keep praying. Be persistent. That's what the Lord wants you to do. Don't be discouraged. Keep on praying. The Lord wants us to do that. Just like Jacob didn't give up in the middle of the struggle. Christian, don't give up praying. The Lord wants you to keep praying. Jacob had an encounter that changed his life. It changed his name, and it changed his walk. If you don't know Christ as your Savior, if you're listening to this at whatever time that you may be listening to it today, and you don't know Christ as your Savior, stop resisting God's tug at your heart and ask Christ to save you today. He wants to change your name, and He wants to change your life. Ask the Lord to save you today. For those of us that call ourselves Christian, praise the Lord, we have a changed name. But is our life showing that change in us? Let us live a life that God can bless. Let us live a life as Jacob did here with his encounter with the wrestling with the angel, and see that we can live a life that is pleasing to God, and we can give it all over to God in full trust and faith in His perfect plan for our life. Let's pray. Lord, thank You for this lesson. Thank You for this passage. Lord, You made it fresh and anew to me. And I pray today, as this has shared, as this is watched and listened to, Lord, I pray that maybe somebody this morning is struggling with something they've maybe been praying for years. Maybe they're stressed. Maybe they're worried over the atmosphere around us. Lord, I pray that You'll give them peace. Give them the understanding. Give us the understanding that You want us to fully trust You, and that's where the blessing is. Lord, help us, Lord, as we're called Christians, Lord, to live a life that You're able to bless. Live a life that's pleasing. Lord, help us take out the impurities in our life. Lord, the things that you're not pleased with. Lord, help us to remove those. Lord, and replace those with things that You are pleased with. Replace those with things like the fruits of the Spirit. Lord, help us to be more like You, we pray. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you.